Hi, I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. This is a closer look at Star Trek The Next Generation, Season 3, Episode 6, Booby Trap. We start off with a nice beach scene on the holodeck with Geordi. He's on a date with, her name is Christy. It looks like he put a lot of work into this program and even has a violin guy show up. I know this isn't correct, but it looks to me like he's wearing like an orange safety vest. Unfortunately, Christy really isn't into Geordi.
It's been a lovely program, and...
Yeah.
You're a terrific guy.
Yeah.
I just don't feel that way about you.
Knock it off.
Now we're in 10 forward with Data and Wesley playing some 3D chess. It looks like there's a debris field outside. That's what's left from some ancient battle. We'll find out more later. Geordi walks in and he's all bummed because his date with Christy didn't go well. Riker calls Data to the bridge. They are picking up some signal, and it seems to be an ancient code. It can't be from the survivors of the battle I mentioned. Picard's curious, so they move in to check it out. It doesn't take them long to find the source of the signal.
The Promethean battle cruiser,
and its Lang cycle fusion engine still intact.
Sensors indicate no life signs aboard, Captain.
I should hope not, Mr. Data. That ship belongs in a museum.
Picard says, well, we're a bit late. That signal probably originated over 1,000 years ago. They must have awesome batteries.
We have arrived at Orleus 9 to chart the battle in which the Menthars and Promelians fought to their mutual extinction. Among the ruins, we have found a relic, a Promelian battlecruiser that has withstood the centuries.
Picard's all excited and wants to go check out the Promelian battlecruiser himself. Riker's like, yeah, how about Worf and I go check it out first to make sure it's safe? And I agree with him. But Picard says, too bad, Captain's prerogative. What are you afraid of, ghosts? Riker is totally right here. 1,000 years can take its toll on a ship, but it's not a problem. Data says that he checked it out and there's life support and all that, somehow.
It is exactly as they left it, Number One. In the bottle.
The ship in the bottle. Oh, good Lord. Didn't anybody here build ships in bottles when they were boys?
I did not play with toys.
I was never a boy.
I did, sir.
Thank you, Mr. O'Brien.
So we're on the old battle cruiser, and the away team has got some pretty impractical flashlights. Hey, there's the captain. Yeah, he's been dead a long time. Worf says that it's admirable as they obviously died at their posts. Picard is all thrilled to be checking out all this history.
Do you have anything stronger than this, Guinan?
Yes.
Would it help?
No.
As a woman, what's the first thing you look at?
His head.
His mind, of course.
I'm attracted to bald men.
Guinan says that a bald man was kind to her once, and this is a weird time paradox because she's talking about Picard. But we don't get to see any of this until Season 5. I'll point it out when we get there. They're just talking about how Geordi doesn't have much luck with the ladies. Yeah, this is the kind of blah-blah stuff I usually skip, but it actually comes back around later. Data gets some lights up and running, and Worf shuts off the distress signal that's been going for centuries.
I believe this is an information storage device. A crude analog of our own isolinear optical chip.
Is there any way to see what's on this?
Its components are quite old.
So Data gets that thing working, but they play back the captain's last log entry, and he's just like, yeah, I take full responsibility for the fate of this vessel and all the lives lost. I wonder what happened to him. Back on the bridge, Picard is all giddy about the battleship thing, but now it's time to go. Worf says, uh-oh, they're suddenly being bombarded with high-level radiation. That's not good. Riker orders shields up, and Data says that their energy output is slowly being drained.
Energy loss increasing, sir.
Mr. Crusher, reverse course, full impulse power.
No response, sir.
Matter-antimatter mixture ratio settings at optimum balance. We should be going like a bat out of hell.
Picard says, uh-oh, we may have fallen into the same snare that killed those old dead guys. 1,000-year-old booby trap. What to do? Geordi says at the rate they're going, their energy reserves will be depleted in 3 hours. Then no shield and, you know, radiation. Worf says he cannot determine its source and they have no idea what's draining their power. Riker asks Data if he has any files on this, and he doesn't. So it's decided the best thing to do is to go back to the battlecruiser and look for clues. Scooby-Doo time.
I recommend we evacuate and seal off all non-operational areas.
After the shields fall, how long before fatal exposure?
30 minutes. After that, there is nothing that can be done.
Away team to Enterprise.
Riker chimes in. The away team has found something. It's a bunch more of the captain's logs. They're going back to the Enterprise to check them out. Geordi's in engineering trying to figure out how to fix the engines and gets the idea to recreate the original design from the Utopia Planitia shipyards on the holodeck with the engine's original designer. Oh, here we go. That's pretty cool. And that's Dr. Leah Brahms, played by Susan Gibney. We'll see her again in TNG and then 30 years later on Lower Decks, both as Leah Brahms.
It's good to see you, Leah.
Systems L452 through L575 will accept reactants.
We could do it.
Captain, we've found a way to extend the matter-antimatter energy supplies.
Well done, Mr. LaForge.
Okay, so Geordi tells the captain the good news, but they don't have enough power for propulsion yet. At least the shields will be fine for now. Brahms and LaForge get back to work, but Geordi thinks this version of Brahms is a little dry. So he asks the computer to give her a personality, which it can do because of the records it has of, like, her lectures and stuff. Geordi's like, that's cool, let's do it.
It's me, Leah. Don't start calling me Dr. Brahms or I'll call you Commander LaForge. We've managed to maintain energy, but we can't leave it in this realignment forever without burning out components. Are you with me?
Yeah.
I bet Geordi falls for a hologram. Riker does it. Data has gotten some of the old dead captain's log entries working. Basically, he just says that they were in the same situation that the Enterprise is in now. He mentions aceton assimilators, and Data says those are old-school generators that can drain energy from distant sources, and apparently these things can then take that energy and turn it into radiation. Got it. Back to the holodeck, and Geordi and Leah are arguing because he sucks at dealing with women. But he's got a point. She is looking at the problem from a textbook point of view, and Geordi has all kinds of practical experience. Eventually, she agrees with him, and he's like, haha, yeah, damn right.
You're good. Very good.
I know my ship. Inside and out.
Well, then you must know me inside and out. Because a lot of me is in here.
Fortunately, Riker calls Geordi to the bridge before they, like, start making out or something. Data tells us that considering the size of the radiation field, there must be several hundred thousand of those acetone things. Worf has detected that one of them has, like, a 0.1% weakness in energy or something, so Riker wants to shoot phasers at it. Geordi's like, well, if we do that, we might blow some circuits and we may lose shields.
There is also the possibility that the phasers will supply the assimilators with what they need most, energy.
You know, I imagine a very similar discussion taking place in our neighbor ship.
Well, let's hope our decisions are more successful than theirs were.
So they decide to fire phasers anyway. And that didn't do anything except for make things worse. Now there's more radiation and more energy drain. Geordi and Leah are hard at work, but energy is getting really low, so the computer shuts off the holodeck. What to do? Again. Worf says they have less than 2 hours of shields left, and the radiation has increased 17%. The doc says that means that they will hit lethal exposure in 26 minutes once the shields fail. Picard asks Geordi how things are going down there, and he's like, well, you turned my holodeck program off. I kind of need that. So Picard tells the computer to bring it back online. Leah Brahms is back, and she and Geordi figure that there must be a slight time differential between the energy drain and the radiation output, so they can probably use that somehow.
Do you like Italian food?
Like it. Wait till I make you my fungili.
Okay. Fusion reactor uplink to navigation processor.
The problem is that the time difference thing I mentioned happens too fast, and Geordi can't adjust their systems fast enough. Brahms is like, well, I could do it. But Geordi's like, nah, Data isn't even fast enough. She means the main computer could do it. Picard stops by, and Geordi tells him they have a chance, but they have to turn the ship over to the computer. I mean, that's pretty much how it works all the time, if you think about it. Picard asks if this is the only way, and Geordi's like, yeah, I think so. Those two are running simulations, which aren't going well, when, the shields have failed. Lethal exposure in 26 minutes.
Everything we've tried to do has been based on overpowering the trap. More energy, faster adjustments. But that's exactly what we can't do because that's what we're supposed to do. The answer lies in our own computer. The mind.
The plan is to shut everything off except for life support and two thrusters and all the lights and navigation, as we'll see. But it's supposed to be like the computer and everything. That should starve the acetone things long enough for them to get out of there if they fly out manually. So Picard takes the helm because he's obviously the best pilot on the whole ship. And here we go. Worf says they'll be entering the debris field in 8 seconds. I'm pretty sure they're already in the debris field, but whatever. So they are flying around, and this is not nearly as exciting as you'd think.
The gravitational attraction of the various masses has reduced our velocity by 8%. By my calculations, we no longer have sufficient momentum to clear the debris field.
Thank you, Mr. Data.
The asteroid's gravitation is drawing us closer.
There's no way an asteroid that size has enough gravity to make a difference. Of course it works, though, and Picard does a nifty maneuver around the asteroid.
You have used the asteroid's gravitational pull as a slingshot. Excellent.
We're out. We got through. You have a call, Mr. Crusher?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, no way that should have worked. Maybe the asteroid's really, really dense. So Worf shoots some torpedoes at the old battleship so no one else gets stuck like they did, except the acetone generators are all still there, like 100,000 of them, so that didn't do anything. Geordi stops by to apologize to Leah Brahms for shutting her off. They make a good team, and she tells him that every time he touches the engine, it's like touching her. Okay. And then they kiss. We'll eventually find out that the real Leah Brahms is happily married and is not super thrilled when she finds out about all this.
Computer. Exit holodeck. In program.
Believe it or not, this is the first episode of Star Trek ever to be directed by a woman. Of course, that becomes much more common. When Guinan tells Geordi that a bald man was kind to her, yeah, she's talking about Picard, because eventually he goes back in time to the late 19th century on Earth, and she happens to be there. And we'll see all that in Time's Arrow. Yeah, I kept calling them acetone generators. Acetone is nail polish remover. Acetone is spelled the same way, just without the E at the end. There's a gag reel specific to this episode, and since I included that scene, I thought you might want to see it. Well, here.
Ship in a bottle. Good Lord. Didn't anybody build ships in bottles when they were boys?
I never played with boys.
I think that's funny just because of how serious Worf usually is. Well, it's time for a rating, and I have to admit I'm a little biased because I like Leah Brahms. I like this episode, though at the end I felt flying out of the debris field thing was a little boring. But I'm still going to give this one 4 deltas out of 5. You can let me know how you feel about that. If you liked that video, thanks a lot. Make a comment and subscribe if you haven't done so. If you didn't like it, sorry to hear that. There's more Star Trek videos and other related content on my website. Check it out at kellyplanet.com. I'm Eric Kelly. Live long and prosper.